Would you please welcome in Professor Wright? Would you come front and center here? Either place. Now, in addition to Bishop Wright on our panel discussion this morning or afternoon, then I'll go to Bruce next. Bruce Corley is a Pauline scholar for decades. How many years have you taught your Pauline seminar? 18? 18 years his Pauline seminar, as claiming to have read everything N.T. Wright has written. I don't think N.T. Wright has read everything N.T. Wright has written, so I'm not sure that that's possible. No, but I do see Dr. Wright's got his Greek New Testament here. I brought mine as well, and mine has AIDS. to get us ready for this, but anyway, I want to thank Bruce Corley for being here. Bruce is here as well. Bruce, would you join us on the panel? Bruce is a professor of New Testament and a professor of Greek at this point at, it's called the B.H. Carroll Theological Institute. It's there in Dallas. And then we have Ross Wagner. Ross is with Duke at this point again and is a fantastic person. Duke is where Richard Hayes hangs his hat, who is not only a good friend, but I believe you've dedicated this latest massive work to Richard Hayes, who Dean Hayes, by the way, I asked him to be here, and he wanted to be here to be on the panel as well, but he had other commitments and is not able to be here, much to my regret, but we'll have him back. He's a friend of the library and a friend of what we do here and a good personal friend, so we'll have him back at another moment. But at this point, he sent Ross and said Ross is his thoroughbred. So we don't need to worry about anything. We have Ross Wagner. Would you join me in welcoming Ross? Thank you, Ross. Ross is an associate professor of New Testament at Duke, and so it's an honor to have him. Now, here's the format for today. The format's one that we're inventing as we go along. No, I told these gentlemen not to prepare anything, that their life has been their preparation, and I want to ask them some questions. And I'm not into this to try and get into the new Paul, which is now the old new Paul, because we now have the new Paul, and then we have the neo-new Paul, and the new neo-unipaul Paul. That's not my issue. My issue for today is let's try and get to know these scholars and some of their insights, and we'll do some of it on a level that's very, almost Larry Kingish. But we'll also do some of it on a level that digs down a little deeper. I want them to have the freedom to respond to each other. This is one that I'll try and moderate as best as I can. I'll throw in an occasional story. We'll see what happens. So work with me on this, and let's see if this is an enjoyable exercise. I want to start with Professor Wright. Professor Wright, how did you become friends with Paul? Tell us where this relationship started.
Good question. In a sense, my friendship with Paul started when I was 4.5 years old, because it was the coronation day, June the 2nd, 1953, which happened to be my mother's 30th birthday, and my sister and I, she's a year older than me, were given coronation Bibles, little chunky King James Bibles with the crown on the front and the date and so on as a commemoration. Naturally, these were our first Bibles. I had only just learned to read. My sister was a little ahead of me there. But being given these extraordinary objects, I remember we retreated to the nursery, which we still shared, and we sat on the floor and leafed through this extraordinary little book. And I remember looking at Chronicles and goodness knows what, and this is far too much. You know, I was just about managing Thomas the Tank Engine in those days. but we found the letter to Philemon, a single page which looked as though it was manageable. And my sister and I read Philemon to one another on June the 2nd, 1953. And I've always had, this is why I start the book, the big book, with Philemon. It's not the only reason, but it's kind of nostalgic for me. That's where I came in. A sense of, here's a deeply human story. And maybe somebody explained it to us. Maybe my mother sort of said, well, such and such. But I never forgotten that moment, and it was very important to me. I didn't really then think much about Paul until my late teens, when I was in the Christian Union in Oxford University. And as zealous young Christian students do, we were very buzzy about all sorts of issues that were going on in the Christian world, in the evangelical Christian world, and again those issues seemed to land somewhere in relation to debates about Paul. What did he mean? What was Romans 7 about? Was this the Christian or the non-Christian? All sorts of questions like that. And we just got fascinated, and because I was doing classics, I was reading Greek anyway, so you know, the Greek New Testament wasn't a problem from that point of view, so I was quickly into that. And then when I then did a second degree in theology and then wanted to do research, my main criterion for choosing a research topic was something that would keep me in touch with both Old and New Testaments, which meant finding a bit of the New Testament that was deeply related to the Old Testament, and the choice for me came down to John or Paul. And I went to see George Caird, who was to be my supervisor, and he actually advised me against doing Old Testament and John. He said it would involve all sorts of stuff about lectionary theories and so on, and I was quite glad because I had really wanted to do Paul anyway. So that's where it went to, and I, in a sense, though I've been round the houses and back, I've never stopped.
Fantastic. Bruce? Now, in hearing that and knowing you've read everything that Professor Wright has written, my question for you out of the box is this. Other than Professor Wright, whose writings about Paul have you found influential in your life?
Well, that's a long story. The beginning point for me was in seminary, and the Paul book we used was Paul, Apostle of the Heart Set Free by F.F. Bruce. But I went to seminary with a question which came from my days as a youth evangelist. I got hooked up with a triple-edged Calvinist who went visiting with me, and he would look at people and decide they were sheep or goats.
And did he have a God complex?
And I knew there was something wrong with that, so I came out of a math and physics background with a question. I'm going to tackle what the Bible says about election. So when I went into the doctoral program, I already had a target in mind, and along the way, I got heavily involved in Old New Testament research. I team taught with a colleague of mine for several years the New Testament use of the Old Testament. And those two things stuck me on Romans 9 through 11. One of the first things I did was to translate Adolf Schlatter, God's Righteousness, because I wanted to get a feel for an evangelical German scholar. And after that, I read everything on Romans 9 and 11 I could find. And I found out in 1982, I was in Cambridge, and Tom's dissertation was in Tyndall House. My dissertation was 280 pages. His was two volumes over 1,000 pages. And he's made a career out of it.
Very, very good. Very good. Okay, Ross. Let me pick up from there. So, do you teach Romans 9 through 11?
Yeah, I actually wrote a doctoral dissertation on that too.
So all three of you wrote how many pages?
In print, 400 something.
Okay, well, you've got the middle ground here.
Go.
So, I'm sure everybody would love a snapshot. So, Romans 9 through 11, official view, Ross Wagner.
Oh my. Okay. Well, actually, my book is on the way Paul reads with and thinks with Isaiah.
Okay.
But most of the Isaiah material ends up in 9 to 11 and in chapter 15.
Some would say all of Romans is Isaiah in some ways,
that's
but
true.
All right,
that's
go
true.
Ahead.
Well, so we've had some discussions this week, I think actually there's probably a good deal of
all right, you got to hold that close so
Sorry.
They hear you
all
in
right.
the back.
There's a good deal of agreement, at least on the ends of the table here. That there's the older view that we all talk about. C.H. Dodd, amazing, influential New Testament scholar who just thought Paul maybe needed to fill some pages on the manuscript and drop 9 to 11 in Romans, but doesn't really belong. But especially since World War II and the whole Christian rethinking of the relationship of church and Israel, 9 to 11 has been seen as more essential to Paul's account of the gospel. And this has gone hand in hand as well with this so-called new perspective on Paul, the discovery that Paul's mission, his mission context, his fostering of communities of Gentiles and Jews that worship Jesus, the Messiah of Israel, that this is the context in which Paul talks about things like righteousness, justification. And so Romans 9 to 11 is Paul's most lengthy and coherent attempt to think through how is it that what God has done newly for Israel and for the world in Jesus the Messiah, his death and his resurrection, how does that relate to the promises that God made to Abraham and to Isaac and Jacob? How does it relate to the living descendants of Abraham, some of whom, like Paul, are followers of the Messiah, but many, by the time Paul pens Romans, who have set themselves in opposition to this, not heard it as good news at all. And my own take is that Paul, as he writes Romans, he says at the end in chapter 15, in fact, asks prayer from the Roman Christians. He's going to Jerusalem. He's bringing this gift from Gentile churches in Macedonia and Achaia. And he prays, first of all, that this gift will be accepted by the believers in Jerusalem, but then also that he'll be saved from people he calls unbelievers in Jerusalem. He knows that he's going to have to give an account of himself, both to fellow Christ followers and perhaps to a less sympathetic audience. And at the same time, he's trying to introduce himself to the churches in Rome. From what we can tell from non-New Testament evidence, there's a strong Jewish character to early Christianity in Rome. He's trying to enlist people to join him in a mission further to the west in Spain. And so he's also offering an account of his gospel. And so the place that Israel has in the purposes of God is the topic of Romans 9 to 11. What does Paul say in a nutshell? He's trying to hold together two convictions that he won't budge from. First of all, that God has not rejected the people that God foreknew, that God had, this is election language. He's holding, on the one hand, election. On the other hand, he's holding firmly, without budging, the conviction that God has acted in Jesus for Jew first and also for the Greek. And that's what creates the tension in Romans 9 to 11, and that's also what creates lots of different interpretations.
Okay, so with that, you deserve a water. And Professor, so you don't run out as well. All right, Bruce, we're putting you in the middle here. Romans 9, 10, and 11, do you want to give us your perspective there?
Well, for the first 90% of Tom's treatment, and by the way, of course, his dissertation has it, but he had a large section in his first essay-type book, Climax of the Covenant. And then the largest exegetical section in Paul and the Faithfulness of God is 100 pages plus, and it is on Romans 9, 10, 11. And he has not budged across the years. As I count it, about a 35-year span that he's worked with this. So for 90% of his argument, I agree with him. And Ross's materials feed into Paul and the faithfulness of God in terms of the story of Israel. Where I'm the dissenter is on the connected prophecy. It's really earlier in the argument, but specifically when Paul introduces the mystery in verses 25 and following. And there's a sequence there, hote, that a hardening has happened. And whether the hardening is partial in terms of part of the people or partial in terms quantitatively, I think makes no difference. Then there's a temporal particle, a dual one, akri hu, until the fullness of the Gentiles comes in. And for me, that sets a temporal pattern which answers to what he has already argued about a remnant in Israel. And then kai houtos, and then, and Tom Ross both argue that it is modal in the sense, in this way, that is, the coming of the Gentiles to salvation. But I'll go back and pick that up in a moment. This is the way all Israel will be saved, and pos Israel is the corporate body of all those who are in Christ, Jews and Gentiles. So my problem with Tom's overall picture is that he has argued at great length for a narrative that has Israel in exile and a restoration that comes through the reworking of monotheism and election, Jesus and the Spirit, and this is the hope of Israel. But then in Romans 11, where there actually could be a restoration of these kinsmen according to the flesh, it's a big letdown. Paul wants to save some of them. And Tom argues, using Ross's material as support, that the regrafting of the branches that are natural branches that have been cut away from the olive tree is a regrafting into Israel. Hence, these Gentiles are already foreseen by Paul as being a part of Israel, and that is the way he can support the argument that the term Israel doesn't refer to the ethnic kinsmen of Paul, includes them, some of them, but really it's a statement about the complete Israel of God, namely the church. I think there is a temporal segment that runs all through the narrative. I do believe it has eschatological overtones. I think he fights against some ghost here, millennial ghost, dispensational ghost, whatever. I don't think there's anything in Romans 11 about a theocratic restoration or the land of Palestine or anything else. It is a charismatic statement. I just think that Paul expected that this mysterion, this mystery, is truly an apocalyptic turnabout. It is revolutionary. So that which was a remnant, a lima, becomes a fullness. And for Paul, it is an imminent now. I think the reading noon for the hope being now is proper. So we don't have that big a disagreement, though it lodges in a pretty wide place.
Okay, Professor. Any response to what we've heard, or do you want to just give us the right version of Romans 9, 10, and 11?
It's
W-R-I-G-H-T, right version.
I'm grateful for Dr. Corley's very careful summary, not only of my view, but of his. I'm not sure how appropriate it is actually to go any further with the detailed kind of hand-to-hand fighting of how you read kai houtos in 1126 and things like that. These are things which all of us are capable of writing lengthy footnotes on and so on, and that will continue. But I think that the big general point, it was very interesting the way you said it, Bruce, if I may call you Bruce, when you said it's a big letdown. I think it's only a big letdown because the tradition of reading Romans has been for a long time that, well, Paul says this about predestination, this about Israel's responsibility, and then he's struggling, but then he gets this new thing and, all Israel's going to be saved. And people assume that that's the way the passage goes. So then people feel let down if somebody like me comes along and says, well, actually, I don't see it. Because if you read right through from 11 following, well, from anywhere, but all the way to verse 24, you would not know that this sudden reversal is going to take place. And if somebody says, but Paul is now getting a new mystery, F.F. Bruce in his commentary said that maybe this was, I'm not sure if it was Bruce's own idea or if somebody else, you may remember that, that this was a new mystery which was revealed to Paul while he was writing this. And actually, I think that is demonstrably wrong for this reason, and this is the new thing about the treatment of Romans 9 to 11 in my new book, is that instead of simply taking it step by step through 9, 10, and 11, I actually stood back from the whole thing, and I started by thinking, isn't it interesting, this passage begins with a lament. You know, that I'm speaking the truth in Christ, I'm not lying, I'm in continual pain and sorrow about my kinsfolk according to the flesh. And it's like the beginning of a psalm of lament, almost. And then the passage, the end of chapter 11, ends with a short burst of praise. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God, etc. And I thought, well, that too makes sense as a sort of, like a psalm. You begin with the one, you end with the other. And I then started to think, I wonder if there's any other ways in which this balances out. And I should say, those of you who know about kind of literary criticism of the New Testament, some people have tried to do chiasms, that is sort of A, B, C, C, B, A, and usually I am deeply resistant to these things. They seem to be very artificial. So I kind of wrapped myself over the knuckles and said, no, don't go there, because you know you're not going to believe it in all anyone else. But I thought, well, but let's just have a look and see. And I found, to my surprise, that a lot of the stuff in 9:6 to 29 about the calling and the hardening and the purpose of the hardening and so on was then picked up in 11, well, most of 11 actually, and I started to see then how 9:30 to 33 did seem to be balanced by 10:14 to 21, and I just began to see that maybe the very center of this whole three chapter passage is 10:1 to 13, where Paul says, my heart's desire and prayer to God for them is that they may be saved, and then he tells the story, brings the story of Israel to its scriptural conclusion, which is Deuteronomy 30, where God renews the covenant, and then says in that breathtaking bit of exegesis of Deuteronomy 30, that when somebody confesses with their lips that Jesus is Lord and believes in their heart that God raised him from the dead, that is the fulfillment of Torah in the new covenant of which Deuteronomy was speaking. And that's the answer to the question of how they're going to be saved in 10:1. And because I then started to see the whole section like this, two things follow. One is, this is not Paul winging it. Let's try this argument. Now what are we going to do? Well, go and have a cup of coffee and a walk around the park and then come back and try the next bit. Well, maybe, possibly, but this lands us up in a problem. What are we going to do? Okay, we'll say a prayer. I've just had a new revelation. Maybe it's, you know, that's how a lot of people think it was. I don't think that's so at all. I think Paul had this argument 1,000 times in the lecture hall of Tyrannus, in the back of the shop, goodness knows where, in the synagogue. He knew exactly what he was doing. He structured it very carefully in such a way that he is leading the reader to feel the puzzle of how you get from A to B to C to D, but Paul himself is not being puzzled by this as he's writing it. I think, therefore, that this bit about the mystery is not a new point tacked on the end, despite everything that I've said, I've now got this new mystery. I think that as at the end of 1 Corinthians 15, behold, I tell you a mystery, what you're getting is a different, use the word apocalyptic with fear and trembling if you like, a different kind of take on what he's been saying all through. It's kind of a different sort of lens, but the same material. And since the material is focused on 10:1 to 13, where the salvation is by the renewal of the covenant through Christ and the Spirit, resulting in faith and confession of Jesus as Lord, I then don't think that it's a letdown with a bump when you find that 11:25 following isn't actually saying the same thing. This is merely to restate the case, but to show you how I now get there. I was surprised at this, and I have to say, yes, Bruce is right. Every time I write on Romans 9 to 11, and I've done so many times over the years, it's ended up coming to a similar place, but this argument was completely new, and it came to me step by step when I was in Princeton. But each time I do it, I want you to know, I say to myself, I've said this several times before, maybe I am wrong, and maybe all these good guys like Bruce Corley are actually right, and maybe I need to take a walk around the park and think about it. And I've done that several times, and I've come back to the text, and each time, well, call it systematic blindness if you like, but I'm still where I was.
In that regard, being a a lawyer by trade, not a theologian. Bruce, and unfortunately for those of you who don't know me, I am a trial lawyer, and I am in the middle, actually I'm 3 months into a trial right now, and the judge gave us off today so that I could do this here, which I really appreciate, but it does mean in my brain right now, I'm in the mood to cross-examine anything that gets in my path. And so if I cross that edge, someone just throw a bottle of cold water at me, please. But Bruce, as I hear a very good argument that you make about, it makes 11 seem anticlimactic. You know, the big hurrah is gone. And then I hear from Professor Wright, who is an anti-chiastic scholar by nature, that perhaps there's a chiasm here. And if there is, then that tells us, though it may not fit our Western thinking, but it tells us in our Jewish thinking at least, that in a chiasm, the emphasis and the big explosion and the bang is actually in the middle, and everything's so you expect the big explosion in the middle and you expect the subsidence afterwards to tie it into a nice bow. Does that sway you at all?
Well, I gladly bear witness. Anything that Tom has said in regard to the structure, I agree with. And I wrote this literary structure in 1976. The middle part of my dissertation is a chiastic analysis of the argument. I do not think that he loses track of anything. And I've forgotten, Stephen Friday, I believe he is at New York, he does a lot of analysis of rabbinic homilies, and his principal point is that he's at Yale. You begin at the summary at the end and work backwards. And in Faithfulness of God, Tom tediously goes through each part like that. I am happy to say that I did a similar thing in 1976. And I think there's very solid ground for arguing this as a continuous narrative that unrolls and comes to a conclusion. And the mystery is not something that came up as an epiphany at the end where Paul is desperate. It's the logical outcome in the way that he argues. I just think that the temporal aspect of the fullness of the Jews, they come to a fullness also, the Jews do. In 11, the life from the dead statement, which is not the regular term for resurrection, is for Gnosticism. There's a whole string of medieval and Reformation commentators who take a viewpoint very similar to Tom's. But they think the whole tamale is coming in. In other words, that there's something big in Paul's logic. And that's my point. I would have expected an exile and restoration man to finally get a restoration of this longed for Israel rather than a few. And I think that Paul, were he here, he would not buy the few part.
Okay. So, again, the prerogative of not being a scholar, and I will tell you this, and this is true confession, so the panel does not get upset with me, nor y'all. I had every intention of reading this section of all of these gentlemen's writings before this, but instead I've been dealing with microbiology of P par gamma expression, and unable to do it. So, with some ignorance perhaps in the question, I would ask this. From my perspective, Romans was written to a set of churches in Rome that had undergone their own upheaval, in the sense that if Claudius indeed had evicted the Jews, and the Roman church had been started by, perhaps we get a hint from the Acts 2 passage, that there were some people from Rome at Pentecost, so you've got some Jews that start the church. And I just think, as a 21st century pragmatist, you got a church started by Jews. Gentiles come into the church. The Jews get booted out by the emperor, which leaves the Gentiles in control. And now all of a sudden, in charge of the budget are the Gentiles. In charge of the teaching, the Gentiles. In charge of the Eucharist, the Gentiles. The Gentiles are running the whole show. And then the Jews, Priscilla, Aquila, et al., are allowed back in. And I'm sure they were ready to come back in and say, thank you for holding the boat while we were gone. I'm back to steer the ship now. I'll take back over the budget. I'll take back over this. I'll take back over that. So you've had Jews. The Gentiles come in. The Jews leave. The Jews return. And Paul writes to this church in the midst of this return, trying to teach Jew and Gentile that all of them have the same commonality in Jesus. And that's, to me, a core understanding for the book of Romans. How does that influence, perhaps? Maybe you just want to say, Lanier, you're off your rocker, and that's not it. But if I'm not off my rocker, how does the social implications of what that church has experienced in a similar fashion of starting with the Jews, bringing in the Gentiles, the Jews seeming to leave, the Jews returning. How, if at all, does that affect your reading of what Paul's writing in Romans 9, 10, and 11? Ross, we'll start with you.
Thank you. I think you're exactly right as far as the social situation goes. I would want to point to Romans 15, 7 to 13 as sort of summing up what Paul's trying to do pastorally in this letter. And there are all kinds of connections back to Romans 9 to 11 and other places. But he says, you need to welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. He says, I say this solemnly to you, Christ has become a servant of the circumcised on behalf of the truth of God to confirm the promises made to the fathers and to the Gentiles so that they might glorify God for mercy. And then he goes into this string of citations from Torah and Psalms and prophet to talk about Christ as the Messiah of Israel who rises to rule the Gentiles. Their unity is at stake in welcoming one another. And he's just gotten done in Romans 14 and 15 of talking bread and butter stuff. What do we do at the potluck? Mm-hmm. We're not all eating the same food. What about people who honor this day and others who go to work on this day? And he's saying we have one Lord. We need to love one another and acting in love as Christ loved us and took on one another's shame is the pattern of life. So in the reference to the Messiah bearing others' shame, I think you might get a picture of what it would be like for Gentiles to welcome Jews back. Gentile disdain for Jews is pretty widespread throughout the empire, and especially if Claudius has kicked out part of the community. The Gentiles are to embrace people of lower social status, and they're to do so precisely because Christ has embraced them. So I think the issues in Romans 9 to 11 then, and Tom brings this out very well in Paul and the faithfulness of God, in part, Paul says, I'm talking to you Gentiles. I don't want you to be ignorant of God's plan because you shouldn't be puffed up. God is not done with Israel. In the present time, Israelites are continuing to come to faith in Christ. There's no sense in which the gospel is no longer to be shared with them. Here, actually, I do agree with Bruce that Paul imagines, because he's thinking about God's promises to the ancestors, that in the future, God's going to do something even more spectacular, that is, remove this hardening that seems to have come upon part of Israel, and that more will come. Where I think Tom is right to insist is that their coming, their return to God, their reception, their fullness, is going to involve the same acknowledgement of Jesus Christ as Lord that the Gentiles are now acknowledging, that Paul and his fellow Jews are now acknowledging. But Romans 9 to 11 is a way of saying, you know, Gentiles, you're in the family of God now because of the mercy of God. That's the only grounds of your trust. And because mercy is the only grounds of our trust, that's Israel's hope too. Some have been hardened. It's a mystery. It's a strange thing. But God's promises remain firm, and God is going to show mercy to Israel as well.
So would you agree with me that perhaps we're seeing in 9, 10, and 11 an echo in almost a synopsis fashion of Paul saying what you're seeing on a micro scale, the church at large will see on a macro scale and have the right attitude about it.
So I will confess I had not thought of it exactly that way, but that's a really intriguing idea, that our own experience as a community has been people separated from us and now they're back. I think that's actually exciting. I'd be curious what you all think.
Just say that again. I'd just like to get my head around it.
Okay. This is...
Because if Ross agrees with it, it must be right. But I mean,
I mean to me, as a layman, admittedly, to me as a layman, if I understand the historical background that may be prompting a lot of Paul's writing, this is a church started by Jews, Gentiles, and then so from that analogy, I extend it out to say that 9, 10, and 11 is saying what you are experiencing, Roman church, on a micro scale is going to be happening on a macro scale in the history of the world. And so, you know, it started with the Jews, the Gentiles got grafted in, but the Jews are coming back. And so 9, 10, and 11 is the macro view of the microcosm experience of the church.
There was one little cog that I was slipping, and I've got it now.
Okay.
Yeah. You better answer this. Cass, close to your...
Well, you're carrying coals to Newcastle. Tom actually espouses that view in Paul and Faithfulness to God, and I think it's probably a majority view now among commentators.
About the historical situation,
yeah.
Not the analogy.
Right.
No, but my question is, what does that speak to 9, 10, and 11 if we consider 9, 10, and 11 in light of that historical view?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm sitting there, if I'm a Gentile reading 9, 10, and 11, I'm sitting there thinking, holy smoke.
If you work through Romans 1 through 11, sounds like a dialogue with the Jews. And in fact, Irenaeus called it that, because they are foreground. But when you get into the last part of the letter, then Gentile issues begin to come up.
You don't see Gentile issues in the early 1 and 2?
That description, I no longer say that's just the Gentile world.
Okay.
But you'll remember that the target in 2 is the self-righteous Jew. And he apostrophizes the Jew through those early sections. So if I were listening to this, I were a Gentile, I'd start thinking, okay, I'm happy. But in 9 through 11, as Ross said, then I'm not so happy. So I do believe there is a carrying out of an address of the gospel in equity to both Jew and Gentile. That is the theme of the letter.
All right.
That is surely right. And yes, your historical placing is what I said in my commentary and what lots of us have said. It's not new to me. Right. About Claudius's expulsion of the Jews. That's not as firm a bit of ancient history as we'd like it to be, but it seems to be reasonably clear that something like that happened, that a lot of Jews at least, I mean, presumably not every last one of them, etc., left town. But what it's playing into, and this I think is important for our reading of Romans 11 following all the way through, is that Paul has glimpsed rather clearly the danger in Rome of an early version of what by the second century we call Marcionism. That is, this Gentile snootiness, a sort of Gentile self-righteousness. Who are these funny Jews? They're from the Orient. They've got funny habits. They do odd things. They have a lazy day once a week. You know, this is the normal Roman polemic. You get it in Martial and Juvenal and goodness knows who. And Paul is saying, you're not going that route. That is precisely the sort of ethnic superiority complex which I was attacking in chapter 2 when it was the other way around. And so I do think that's clear. Whether you can actually make the analogy then, which is a very interesting point, I'm intrigued by it, but I'm not sure that it really will work. I need to think about that, because I think that would eventually then push for this big picture of a large-scale last-minute conversion of lots of Jews.
I don't know
like
that it needs to, because
it might not.
Jews returned, the yeah. only Jews that were concerned to the Christian community were those that returned within the Christian community.
Yeah, it's a very interesting question. As I said in a lecture last night at HBU, there's all sorts of stuff in the background for us as late 20th century, early 21st century Western European or American readers of the of these questions, because there's all sorts of people who are pushing for some kind of a universalism in Paul, and this is one of the places they want to find it. Romans 5 and Romans 11 are, well, actually what Paul thinks is God's going to save everyone. And I, if that was the theological conclusion Paul had come to, he wouldn't be weeping in Romans 9. He'd say, by the way, you might think I would be weeping at this point, but it's all right, you know. And he doesn't say that. And likewise, of course, there's been a huge thing, especially since the war, since the Second World War, in reaction against casual European anti-Semitism, which caused so much unbelievable, appalling, wicked horror, that people have wanted to pull back and say, well, actually, of course, God must have a secret backdoor plan, as it were, for his people. And I really don't think that's what Romans 11 is saying. And the danger, I think, is if you go too far down that road, I think Ross keeps his balance there. I need to reread what Bruce says and find out exactly where he's coming out. If you go too far down that road, then the Gentiles, who have been convinced by Romans 2 that God does not have favorites, there is no favoritism with God, could turn round to God and say, well, you know, a lot of our lot have not made it, but apparently you did keep a few reserved seats for them after all, and just what's going on. Now, that's putting it very low-grade, kind of downbeat way of saying, but I think if you're not careful, that's where actually quite a lot of modern European and American thinkers want to go, out of a sort of guilt of the Holocaust and so on. And my hope would be, and I quote my friend Peter Oakes, Jewish philosopher from Virginia, on this. I remember Peter in a seminar not long ago saying, you Christians have to go on saying Jesus is the Messiah. We Jews have to go on saying we don't think he is, but we have to go on saying that to one another. In other words, don't let's flatten down our commitments. Don't let's try and be all cozy and nice. Let's be honest about where we are, because it does come down to, is Jesus Israel's Messiah or isn't he? And there are some Jewish thinkers today who actually talk about Jesus as the Christian Messiah, as opposed to the Jewish one, which, of course, makes no sense at all. There isn't such a thing. The word Messiah means what it means, in that it's a Jewish category. And either Jesus was raised from the dead and he is the Messiah, or he wasn't and he isn't. And okay. I think we would all agree on that.
Yeah. All right, I want to shift gears for a moment, and I want to ask you, as incredible Pauline scholars, to what extent has extra biblical material on, directly or indirectly, Paul influenced your perspectives? Now, I'm not talking about 20th century, I'm not talking about medieval, I'm talking about early Christian material, whether it's the Acts of Paul and Thecla, whether it's the writings of Clement, whether it's, do you find that your Pauline perspective has been shaped at all by any early extra-canonical writings? Anybody?
Well, I wish you hadn't said, and I heard you to say early Christian. Second Temple literature is the be-all and end-all of Pauline studies.
Yeah, and I don't mean simply early Christian. So let me, misstatement. So we could include Marcion, we could include early temple, rabbinical writings, anything you want to include.
I just retired from being president. I'd been consigned to a bad place, so I'm back to teaching now. And they had a retirement dinner for me, and I had 38 of my doctoral candidates there, and two-thirds of them were in Paul. And in those dissertations, many of them were on topics like Ross did, Old Testament, etc. And when you do that, you get to do versions of the Old Testament, you get to do Apocrypha, Pseudepigrapha, Qumran, any other floating text that turn up, so that a lot of these dissertations are two-thirds that kind of material. And I don't think Tom Wright could have made the argument he's made without all that other stuff.
Yeah, that's certainly true. One of my own graduate students now in St. Andrews had to do this curious thing. One of the publishers, maybe Zondervan, has produced a set of like baseball cards of theologians. Have you seen that? With pictures of people on the front and with a sort of 150-word summary of their teaching on the back. And he confessed this to me because he had been assigned the one about me. Apparently my picture is on one of these strange cards. And I said, so he showed me what he'd said. And what he'd said surprised me. He said, N.T. Wright has made a lifelong study of Second Temple Judaism and in the light of that has come up with fresh interpretations of Jesus and Paul. And I thought, good Lord, maybe he's right. Maybe that is what I've been doing, but I haven't sort of, I'm a historian, and a historian wants every scrap of evidence that she or he can get, whether it's a coin, whether it's an archaeological discovery, an inscription somewhere, a text, whatever. We just want everything, and it's not a matter of is it in the canon or not. People get very squiffy about this. They say to me, sometimes in print, N.T. Wright insists on interpreting the canonical material in the light of non-canonical material, as though this is a falsification. And I say, well, excuse me, if you're going to read the New Testament, unless you happen to be born with this magic fluency in Koine Greek, sooner or later you're going to have to open a dictionary, a lexicon, and the lexicon is made by people who've been studying all these other texts in order to find out what that word meant at the time. And really, history is just the extrapolation of that. What did sentences like this mean at the time? And one of the things I go around saying is that we need to get back to first century questions. How did this discourse sit? Where did it land? Like, how were people reading scripture then, rather than assuming that the 14th, 15th, 16th, 17th century, which had been so formative in European and American culture, rather than assuming that those centuries asked the right questions and that we've somehow got to force Paul to answer the medieval and Reformation questions. That's not how you do history. People don't want to hear that. So yes, I mean, I was thrilled when, as a young scholar, the new editions of the Scrolls were coming out. I was thrilled when Jim Charlesworth's new edition of the Pseudepigrapha came out. When I was doing graduate work, in order to get half those Pseudepigrapha, you had to go grubbing in the basement of the library for a sort of an edition from 1895 or something. And of course there are dangers because, to put it bluntly, not everybody in the first century had a copy of First Enoch by their bedside. Just because we've got these texts doesn't mean they all did. However, it creates a strong sense, which you get from reading Josephus. This is how they thought. This is how they worked. And then we come back and, goodness, supposing Mark was thinking like that when he edited this bit of material. Supposing Paul, supposing First Peter. So the way I heard your first question was about subsequent Christian material, and one of the things that I find frustrating as a Pauline scholar is how comparatively few of Paul's major emphases are still being buzzy in the church 200 years later. I think Irenaeus gets some of it gloriously right, Tertullian gets some of it gloriously right, but they are forgetting quite quickly some of the very Jewish, some of the very mid-first century issues which made Paul who he was.
I sense Bruce agrees.
I do. Well, I'll just talk about the other side of the coin, though, which is my calling is to teach the New Testament. And there's a danger, I think, with the historical Jesus kind of controlling our reading of the gospel rather than informing it. I think we, at least in Pauline studies as a discipline within the scholarly guild, we tend to read a very truncated canon of Paul's letters. And Thomas protested against that as much as anyone. But for me, the Acts of the Apostles is actually a major text for understanding, in my view, how Paul is understood in the next couple generations. And I would include in the Pauline orbit 1 Peter, the book of Hebrews. 1 Peter maybe not because it wasn't written by Peter, but because there's a lot more back and forth influence among these early apostolic figures. One of the things Acts struggles with, though, I think, in the narrative, is to show how with his distinctive emphases as an apostle to the Gentiles, Paul is still in agreement with, in fellowship with, the apostolic mission out of Jerusalem. And Acts may paper over some of the tensions in a way, although I think it's remarkable in its admission that there are really big arguments about Gentiles early on. And when I go back to Paul then and find him in 1 Corinthians 15, for example, insisting that the outline of the gospel is the same whether it's preached by Paul or by Peter. Acts is helping me to see the way in which Paul is not simply a brilliant thinker, idiosyncratic, but is also a representative of a tradition. And as much as he has to assert his independence, his accountability to Christ and the revelation that he's been given, he also wants to acknowledge that wider tradition. And this is where something like the Acts of Paul and Thecla provides an interesting counterpoint, because there Paul is very much a kind of lone wolf. And certainly the person who wrote Acts of Paul was reading Paul. 1 Corinthians 7 looks, I've never read it the same after reading that Paul's persecuted from town to town because he's convincing marriageable young women to renounce marriage and be brides of the Lord. I mean, there's something to it, but the Paul of the Acts of Paul lacks this, what I guess I would call a sense of the big tradition of Christianity. So my own expertise doesn't extend very far, but I'll just mention Ben Blackwell, who is here in the audience, has written a fascinating book looking at Paul, putting Paul in conversation with Irenaeus and Cyril, is that right? Yeah. On the whole question of what does the transformation of humanity in Christ look like? The later tradition, especially in the East, develops language of becoming like Christ in his exalted divine nature in some respect. And Ben is able to sort of look at how the Pauline tradition might be in conversation with later developments that are based on Paul's text, but that go into other directions. And I think there's an awful lot more to be done along that line that will shed light on Paul by looking at the way in which he was received.
Okay. So, something to
could
add.
Could I just, yeah. Just add a footnote? Because sure. Something Ross said made me think about this. Yes, Acts. When I was writing Acts for Everyone, which I had to do very fast because I was being a busy bishop and I was able just to take a short time, and so I was like 16 hours a day for a week and a bit, just crunching straight through. Anyway, I got to Acts 21 and 22 when Paul arrives back in Jerusalem, and immediately there's a riot, which there usually was, but with the very sharp sense of this is the man who's been teaching all the world to abandon the law of Moses. And I was suddenly struck very forcibly with, actually, this is the man who a few weeks earlier wrote Romans, if he wrote Romans from outside Corinth before making that last journey back. And I'm thinking, Paul has got in his head and his heart all that complex, sophisticated laying out, do we abolish the law, no, we fulfill the law, etc., etc. This is how we handle the Abrahamic promises, the Mosaic Torah, the law is holy and just and good, nevertheless it can't do this. And I'm thinking, here he is standing here with the crowd baying for his blood, how can he possibly explain any of that? They're just not going to take a sort of oral version of a bit of Romans at that point. And it was very striking to me as the kind of a human dynamic of it, that he actually had very good answers for the rather garbled impressions and charges that were being thrown at him. And there's really nothing he can do except say, I have been loyal to the God of my fathers, the God of my ancestors. And they say, no, you haven't. And so it goes from there. But that struck me as Acts actually helping me to get the very real three-dimensional picture of what's going on at the time. It happened also, I was writing that just at the moment when John Piper's book on my view and justification had come out, and so I had some personal reasons for thinking, how do you get this across?
Okay, on a lighter note for a moment, through the mysteries of Doctor Who and his time machine, you find yourself at dinner with Paul, and you're allowed two things. You're allowed a theology question, and you're allowed a personal question. I want to know what your questions are, but we'll break them apart to give you some time to think additionally. So first, you are allowed to ask Paul a theology question. What would you ask him? Whoever's ready first.
What did you mean by all Israel?
My Greek professor, Harvey Floyd, would have said, don't forget, all of Jerusalem was coming out to be baptized by John the Baptist. And if you think that meant all of Jerusalem, Be careful. Okay, go ahead. So that would be your question, really. You got one question, and you're going to ask him about Romans 9, 10, and 11.
You know, I think so, but that's because I'm persuaded, and if I had thought better with your first question and sort of given the baseline, our conversation would have focused more on what is God up to? Because Paul allows God to speak in the I, in the first person, time and time again in Romans 9 to 11, in the voice of, through Scripture. But in Romans 9, God is the one who puts a stone in the path of Israel so they stumble. In Romans 10, God is the one who hardens the rest. He's beyond this elect remnant in the present time. And so Paul thinks that God ultimately is responsible. His story, and going back to Isaiah, going back to Deuteronomy 32, is God is making space for the Gentiles to come in. This is why I think that God will ultimately remove that partial hardening, and there'll be an opportunity for the rest of Israel to come to faith in Christ. But that's where I really want to say, well, if this is central to the truth of God, the faithfulness of God, then it's really important for me to know, by all Israel, did you mean the elect remnant like you and some Gentiles, or did you imagine a fuller family of Abraham, the elect remnant of Israel, the Gentiles, and also some of your kinspeople that God has hardened? Can God be trusted? You seem to say he is, but Tom Wright keeps telling me that all Israel doesn't include that rest that you've hardened. And God is not part of it.
All right. That's a fair question.
It's a theological question in the right sense.
Absolutely.
For Paul, it's not ultimately even about, as he says, it's not about human working or effort. It's about God who calls.
All right. So, Bruce, what question are you going to ask? And by the way, if you're at the same dinner with Ross, that one's been taken.
Yeah, it would probably be 2 Corinthians 5 and its relationship to resurrection. Because New Testament scholars are like space cadets on that passage. There are people who believe that at death there is a sort of a punctual fulfillment of resurrection in another world order. There are people who believe that it refers to a naked interim. Mary Harris did his dissertation at Manchester on the passage. His committee had on it Charlie Mole. And he was only asked one question, and it is this: does the triple particle, Ige Kai, if so be, is that triple particle a statement of faith or a spasm of fear? So resurrection, I've read Tom's book on resurrection, but a lot of the developmental theories about Paul and so on, his thinking, have to do with his moving up on parousia, resurrection. So that's the one I'd put to him.
All right. Professor Wright.
That's a great little story, the Ige Kai in 2 Corinthians 5, 3. And I'm immediately thinking of the Ige Kai Ike in at the beginning of Galatians 3, which could be a sort of a rhetorical spasm of fear. We could have a little seminar on the use of Paul's particles, but I guess you don't want to do that just a moment.
Next time.
Next time. As soon as you asked the question, I knew what my answer ought to be, and I've spent the last 5 minutes fighting it and saying, no, let's not go there. It would have to be 1 Corinthians 11. What exactly is Paul talking about when he talks about this sequential image, that as though males are somehow in the image of God while the females have that relation to the males? I don't think that's the way Paul says it elsewhere. I sometimes wonder whether that is Paul actually in his more teasing mode, whether there's something going on in the church to which he's addressing a sort of quizzical way of supposing, of what if, because I have real difficulty lining up the ikon and doxa and so on there with what he says about ikon and doxa elsewhere. And of course, what he says about in Christ there's neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, no male and female. I think I know what the main thrust of the passage is. I think the main thrust of the passage is that when, not if, but when women are leading in worship in the church, they should look like women and not like men. And not like, or not as a sort of identikit or degendered person. In other words, they should dress in church like women, and they should be happy to do that, and the church should be happy for that. My problem is, if that's what he's saying, I'm not sure that I understand yet how that bit in the middle contributes to it.
I have a really wacky view on that passage that I would love to run by you sometime, but I won't bore everyone with it. But I honestly have a really wacky view on that passage that to me makes so much sense and just seems to be right that I would love to visit.
Oh, that's great. So we don't need to wait till I can ask Paul. You can just tell
no,
me.
No, I have no clue. I'll be the first to say it's not at all what he meant. I got no clue what he meant. It's just a wacky view. But I would love to share my wacky view with you sometime. All right, Bruce, we did theology. Let's go personal question. You get to ask Paul a personal question. What you got?
Well, since I've written on it twice now, I don't want to know what happened at Damascus. I want to know what happened when he left Damascus. What was he thinking? What changed?
Very good.
I'm so taken with Paul's view of unity in Christ. Welcome one another. The Christ hymn in Philippians 2 and about putting one another's interests first. So I would want to ask, how come you and Barnabas couldn't work out your issues? I mean, is that just you kind of being...
Mark came through at the end, though, didn't he?
Yeah, Mark came through at the end. So Paul seems
redemption.
To have... Maybe Paul's still a work in progress, too. But what was that all about? This is your mission, after all, right?
Yeah. All right.
I thought about that, and I thought about that in relation to the Antioch incident, and there is still big debate, you know. Excuse me, Paul, just how did things finish at Antioch? Did you and Peter storm off in opposite directions, or did he say, oh my goodness, yes, you're right, you know? But that's actually a cheat, because that's more of a theological question. I really want to know, were you married, and if so, did she leave you when you became a Christian? Or did she divorce you, or were you divorced, or are you a widower? Did she die, or what? You don't need to know that, but it seems to me it kind of hovers on the edge in bits of 1 Corinthians particularly. I think it's likely that somebody from Paul's context and background would have been betrothed very young and married comparatively young by our standards, and that I think it's possible that some of the extreme pain that we see in, say, Romans 9 is because there are people who have been extremely near and dear to him who have said, that's it, we're out of here. I don't know. I don't want to indulge in a psychologizing. However, it seems to me a perfectly appropriate historical question to ask.
Do you put Paul on the Sanhedrin at some point, on the council?
No, Paul is a young Pharisee, and that doesn't mean that he's a member of the senior council. I mean, there's problems about the composition of the Sanhedrin in this period. But, I mean, one of the things we know about the Pharisees is that they are not qua Pharisees in a position of authority. They are a pressure group. They're a religiously based political pressure group. And he's on the hard right edge. I mean, some would want to ask him, is it true you were a Shammaiite before your conversion? I wouldn't want to ask that because it's blindingly obvious he was. A Hillelite wouldn't have gone charging off to Damascus to lead people to prison and possibly have them put to death. Hillelite would have said, let live and let live.
Okay. Now, in the grand scheme of things, in terms of Paul, where do you want to grow? What's next on your agenda? Have you learned everything that there is to learn about Paul? Or where do you want to go next? And we'll start with Bruce, and then we'll go to Ross, and we'll let you finish us up on that, Professor, right?
Well, Tom is tired of Paul. If you add up the prequel, which he has yet to publish, Paul and His Interpreters, with a companion volume, his essays, 33 essays, then this two-volume work, and I gave Ross the pages. It's 2,684 pages, and it's number 10 font. I have to wear my glasses to read it. I told him, I'm working on a big research book on Paul. Haven't touched it for 10 years. But the part of, and everybody and his dog has said something about Paul, the part of it that is unique is I am trying to pull together a history of the interpretation of Paul from the beginning up to the present. In fact, it'll probably end with Wright. So that's where my interest will be for, but I've got about a 5-year writing program in mind.
Fantastic. Ross, what's your interest in Paul? Where's it taking you next?
I'm not sure I'll get to writing about this, but the kinds of things I'm most interested in reading right now have to do with Paul's mission in the cities of the Roman Empire. Just how did Paul interact with the daily life, the cultural artifacts, the propaganda? This, I got to come and take a seminar with Tom, learn how to read archaeology. But how was Paul an evangelist, a missionary? How did he cross these cultural lines? Did what he was his message in Lystra different from his message in Philippi? How did he contextualize the gospel? Because I think in that sense we're very much in a period of tremendous pluralism and the opportunities with the world coming to our doorstep. I learned this week that Houston is now one of the top two or three diverse cities in America. And how might we learn to be church again in a context where there are many gods and many lords, and people don't know the name of Jesus?
This is your chance to tell us about what's coming.
Well, Bruce has already said I'm trying to finish off my book on Paul and his recent interpreters, but that is basically very recent interpreters, the last century or so. And there's a reason for that, which is that when I was a graduate student, the kind of recent history of Pauline interpretation was basically footnotes to Bultmann and Caseman and people, and with, C.H. Dodd and Charles Cranfield on Romans, etc. But it was quite clear what the questions were, quite clear what the options and how all that stacked up. Now, the thing is all over the map. We have Paul and philosophy, ancient philosophy, and Paul and the modern philosophers. We've got secular atheistic philosophers in Europe writing about Paul, which is fascinating. You'd never have predicted that. They're coming up with some very interesting stuff. We have all the Paul and politics stuff. Was Paul really aiming to pull the rug from under the ideology of the early Roman Empire? And if so, how does that work? And so on and so on and so on. So there are several, maybe 8, 10, 15 quite different conversations going on in the scholarly guild about Paul. And actually making a map of those is about as complicated as making a map of the London Underground, because there's all these different things and we all come through the same stations, namely Romans, Galatians, Philippians, 1 Corinthians, etc. But actually we're on different lines, and if you just think because you're at this station and somebody's written about this station, then they must be going the same place as you are. No, that's not the case. This is very, very confusing for postgraduate students particularly, as they're struggling to get into what's actually going on. They pull a book off the shelf and it's just not about what they thought it was going to be about. And so I want to try to do some of that detailed map work. That's actually a work which is, I'm hoping, it's supposed to be finished off and published by SBL this year in San Diego in November. So I've got my work cut out the next 3 or 4 months to pull that all together finally. The big thing that I'm looking forward to doing is the international critical commentary on Philippians, which I've been supposed to be doing for years and years and years. Like many other people who have been commissioned to write ICCs, it feels more and more as though I'm leaving it to my retirement. I hope that won't be the case. But Philippians is fascinating. I'm very glad it's only 4 chapters, because doing the ICC is this big commentary series where you basically comment on everything, all the textual variants, everything. Philippians, I think it might just be manageable, but Philippians is interesting because it does several things which don't really seem to happen elsewhere, and particularly there is an implicit philosophical engagement and I think an implicit cultural and political engagement, back to what Ross was saying, in a way which is a bit more striking than you get in at least some of the other letters. And I think with the Christ hymn in the middle of chapter 2, which I do think ends up as being a strong hint that Jesus is Lord and therefore Caesar isn't, and I think we can see that being worked out elsewhere. How does Paul prepare for that? What is his vision of Christian citizenship? What does he mean when he says, whatever is true and lovely and honest and of good report, think about these things? That's not a doctrine of sort of old-fashioned total depravity, that in the sense that everything outside the door of the church is just darkness and misery and gloom and don't go there. There is a generous spirit about that, while at the same time, I warn you about those whose end is destruction and whose God is the belly and whose mind is on earthly things. So there's an incredible sense of figuring out what it means for a church in a city like Philippi to navigate how you get through the pagan world with this cheerful sense of celebrating because Jesus is Lord. So I'm really looking forward to engaging with it, not just, you know, what's the theology of Philippians, what's the exegesis of this and that verse, but I actually see Philippians as quite a sharp little clear window on some of those big issues precisely that Ross was talking about. So I'm looking forward to getting into them.
Well, it's a nice segue to what I was going to have as my last set of questions for y'all. So, but I don't want to ask my last set yet. So you've got to remember to say something about Philippians and the ICC commentary in a minute, as I instead ask you this question. All of you have to some degree, got to feel some degree of a camaraderie, kinsmanship, even affection for Paul, because even though you've not known him as an individual in terms of your physical contacting world, you have spent so much time with him. You've read his feelings, you've read him when he's happy, you've read him when he's sad, you've studied through his experiences, his thoughts, you've seen the way he expresses himself. So here's the question. If through the magic of the time machine, Paul were to walk into a room and you were just to overhear the conversation, do you think you'd recognize him? Do you think you'd be able to pick out who he was? Simply, if you were thrown back into another world, nobody's using his name, do you know him well enough to where you could probably say, I think this guy's Paul? It's an absurd question, perhaps, but I'd love to hear. And what I'm really digging at is, to what level do you feel an intimacy with this saint that you've spent so much time with?
It's interesting. I remember as a new professor at Princeton, we had a well-known scholar of the Gospel of Mark visit us, and I was thrilled to be able to talk to him, and I found out very quickly in the conversation, he hated the Gospel of Mark. And I thought, why did you write then several books on this gospel? You thought it was this terrible piece of work. But no, I think it's a great question. Trying to think the thoughts after someone, you know, my girls are Tolkien fans, and they start talking like J.R. Tolkien. They've read his letters, and they know what he would say about such and so. I'd like to think I could recognize him. I think he would be the center of attention. He'd be talking to everybody, and he'd be talking a lot about Jesus, and he'd be talking about the faithfulness of God. I'm not sure I would like to be his coworker, because I think he was a sort of my way or the highway guy. But I'd be fascinated to be able to overhear what he would say.
I do admire him, not because he's a dauntless type. I think that he was not only gregarious, but that he was very likable. He is the only one who addresses two women by name in an open letter read in a congregation. Not because he denigrates them, but because they are synergoi, and he trusts them that much. Also, my favorite puns are in Paul. He knows how to spin a good joke. And anybody who can smile about religious things, it's got to be all right.
We of course know what Paul looked like.
I mean, the Acts of Paul and Thecla does.
I think seriously, the early iconography of Paul, I think it may have been influenced by the early iconography of Socrates. He's this little dumpy chap. He's got a slight pot belly, and guess what? He's bald and bearded.
And a hooked nose.
Presumably, but. And short, yeah. So I think we might know from that. But if he's in the next room and I can hear the conversation going on, okay, then I'm with my colleagues here. I think we might well say, oh my goodness, that sounds like Paul. That's the way he does arguments. That's the way he's going for it. And that mixture of passionate intensity and pathos, and also the extraordinary facility with the recall of scripture in, I think, Hebrew and Greek, and the ability to see the big picture of it, but also to bring the telling quotation in. And somebody asked me, some of you will know Larry Hurtado, who is professor in Edinburgh, just recently retired. Larry said to me the other day, and this is apropos of the lecture I'm going to do this evening, really, don't you think that Paul may not have been the inventor of Christian theology? There may have been other people before Paul, even earlier Christians, who were doing exactly the same sort of stuff. And I said, well, that's always possible, but actually, people with minds like that do not come along every 5 minutes. You know, we're talking somebody who's up there with Plato or Aristotle or somebody with an extraordinary range of knowledge, an extraordinary grasp, an extraordinary ability to communicate it. That is rare. I mean, look at the next two centuries of the church. They've got the Holy Spirit. They've got all this teaching. They've got the scriptures. The bright lights like Irenaeus and so on, yes, but you don't get somebody with this intensity of Paul. Clement and Ignatius are a pale shadow by comparison.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so what is most impressive about Paul to you?
I think I just said it. I mean,
his brilliance.
It's this combination of it's an extraordinary mind allied to a passionate and deeply compassionate heart.
All right, so here's my last set of questions. You're going to do the international critical commentary on Philippians. You'll address whether or not Paul's using a hymn in there, I'm sure, as you go through it. So what's your favorite Christian hymn? This is just a personal question for you three, so we all know you a little bit better. We're going to start with you, Ross, and we're going to work our way down to N.T. Wright. What's your favorite Christian song?
Number one in the United Methodist hymnal that I grew up with, which is "Oh for a Thousand Tongues to Sing." The fuller version is in the new Methodist hymnal. It's Charles Wesley's poem written on the anniversary of his conversion. It's a hymn that just celebrates the experience of this amazing grace of God, that sense of being forgiven and welcomed that leads to praise and to this, I wish I had a thousand tongues to sing God's praise. I think that's a very Pauline move. I love Tom's observation that Romans 9-11 begins with lament and ends with praise, but all of Paul's letters end in praise or prayer ultimately. "Oh for a Thousand Tongues to Sing."
All right. Bruce, your favorite hymn or song?
Well, I'm a Baptist, but my favorite hands down, and I brought it back from England into my Baptist circle. They had never heard it. And it did not appear in our hymnal until recently. "And Can It Be?" That is the greatest hymn. And it is the greatest Pauline hymn. It's Wesley.
Okay.
This is one of those questions one really would have wanted a day to think about it, because when I was in regular day-by-day, week-by-week ministry, choosing hymns was one of the hardest but also one of the most rewarding tasks, thinking ahead to a service that was coming up in 2, 3, 4 weeks, because people needed to know, musicians needed to know, etc., and trying to get the hymns balanced and which ones hadn't we sung recently and which ones would go with these readings. It's the most extraordinary task, and when you get it right, it is splendid. You feel the energy when the service actually works. So I've got all sorts of things. I was just about to go with "For All the Saints Who From Their Labors Rest," which I love. It's a great narratival hymn celebrating all those who've gone before, but then we join in with them. And it's one of the few hymns, unlike all the ones that end up with us leaving this world and going upstairs forever and ever, which, as you know, is unbiblical. It actually has "Sweet is the calm of paradise, the blessed," and then, "But lo, there breaks a yet more glorious day, the saints triumphant rise in bright array." So I'm always glad. It's one of the ones that gets the eschatology right, 2 Corinthians 5, notwithstanding. Actually, I think that's what it's about, but still. But as you were talking, I thought, no, you got that hymn from England and took it back here. There's a hymn which I've never, ever heard sung in England, but which we sang regularly in Canada, and many of you will know it, as "This Is My Father's World."
Mm.
It's just not known in England, as far as I'm aware. I've not heard it. There's a problem about it, because some people miss out the last verse, and other people change the last verse because they don't like the word battle. But actually, the proper last verse is, this is my Father's world, oh, let me never forget that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. That's kingdom of God stuff. I love it. And then, this is Isaiah 53, this is my Father's world, the battle is not done. Jesus who died shall be satisfied, and earth and heaven be one. That's in a short space. That's the whole eschatology right there. And it's you know, based on a strong theology of creation in the first two verses, wonderful, wonderful celebration.
All right, would you all join me in thanking these gentlemen for their time?